we put the touch on going deeper in our relationship with God. So basically, why we are, we want to go deeper, and where we are in our relationship with God. So it was a topic on where we are, you know, and how much we need to go deeper. It's our relationship on the surface. No, if not, then we can always go deeper and deeper into it. And on the second session, Tommy gave day to day, going deeper to God day to day. So it is hearing and answering God's call on a daily basis, right? To encounter Jesus daily in all that we do, and all that we encounter. And also he talks about being mindful to Christ, the unceasing prayer, just being in that presence of the Lord, you know, always know that he's always there. This helps us to avoid temptation, because he's always there in our minds. You know, when our loved ones on our minds, you know, it is less likely that we will do things which are bad. And also it helps us to build on the gratitude, and also allows us to trust the Lord more because of that gratitude. And eventually, in the times where it is difficult, we can overcome by trusting the Lord in His goodness that He has given us. And on the other session, Basil gave a session on breaking the wall, right? So, what is this breaking the wall? So, it is talking about going deep. Right? Depth. You know, remembering you say depth is gravitas, you know, something which, you know, brings us deeper. Instead of like perhaps compared to going wider, we go deeper. And one of the things he talks about going deeper is not to be stagnant on where we are. So, you know, if our spirituality is still stuck in, even though we have grown up to be working adults, if our spirituality is still kindergarten, then it's very strange. And perhaps then it is God who cause us to go, and we'll not be satisfied with that. And we know from our lives something is missing, you know, it's like we're looking for other things to satisfy us, but something, these things will not satisfy us. And it is indicative of, it is the Lord that's calling us deeper. You know, we become bored easily and all that. Right? And also it talks about breaking the wall is going into the next phase. Right. Especially in times of desolation, it is difficult, because when you are dry and you don't really feel like doing anything, right? You just want to sit down there and do nothing, right? I know this very well. I like to sit down there and do nothing. So this is something that I could relate very well. So today, we want to talk about Eucharist. So it is, I think, somewhat fitting that we go into Eucharist, right? It is something that God has given us to help us to go deeper, right? Something that maybe we have not been very aware of. So I'd just like to read a passage from John, the Gospel of John, John 17:22-23. It says that this is the prayer that Jesus prays to the Father, right? The glory which you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one even as we are one, I in them and you in me, that we may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. Right? So, two verses, but some of the more deep verses in the Gospel of John. So in the context of the Eucharist, you can see that this is talking about God wanting us to be one, right? You know, and not only one, him, Jesus being one with the Father, but He wants to be one with us, right? And in fact, Jesus did say that, you know, before He ascended to heaven, He says, I'll be with you always. So what He left behind is something which is very precious, which is the Eucharist, and indeed He is with us always, till the end of time, He says. So this is And it is a sign that of God loving us, just as God the Father loving us, just as God the Father has loved Jesus. Right, so look at Eucharist. So for most of us who are Catholics, right, Eucharist is something which is not unfamiliar. And for Ronald, who is not a Catholic, he's even more familiar, because he has gone through two lessons in Holy Eucharist. So he knows what is Holy Eucharist very well already. Even better than some of us. He knows. I don't trust him. Ready for baptism, Ronald?
Yes.
Yes. Alright, so for the rest of us who has been going for Mass, it might be something that we take for granted. So we just had a recap, right? I know you're all experts in Eucharist, but you're like, one seventh of your life is Eucharist, man, Sunday Eucharist. Or more, you go on daily Mass, right? Okay, so what is Eucharist, right? So it comes from the Greek word eucharista, which is thanksgiving. Okay? And from the CCC, it says, it is the heart and summit of the church's life, for in it Christ associates his church and all her members with his sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, offered once and for all on the cross to his Father. By this sacrifice, he pours out the graces and of salvation on his body, which is the church. Okay? So it looks very chim, but everything you already know. Okay? So just talk about what is, and this is just one of many things. So we talk, just take one and just break it down and just try to have some talk about the Eucharist. So what is heart and summit? Okay, so we always say that the Eucharist is the source and summit of a worship of our Catholic life, church life, is this here. So why is it so, right? If you look at life, right? Life as a whole, on top of life, the questions that we usually ask is the why questions. So this actually comes from the study of philosophy. So you go higher to understand about life, you go into philosophy to understand about life. And on top of philosophy, as you go higher, then it comes into theology, right? Theology is on the top of philosophy because it talks about God, right? It studies about why God has created or has created life, right? So it talks about the greater scheme where it's even somewhat maybe more difficult to understand where God, which is intangible, right? Then there's the higher philosophy, the theology. And on top of it, the crown of theology is liturgy, right? So liturgy, which is our Mass, where we come to worship and relate to God. So the aim of all our studies, right, from theology, why we study theology, why we study scripture and all that, the aim is actually to come to worship and relate to God and to know who God is. So liturgy, right, which is the summit and heart of it, is really, the aim of our Christian life, where we worship and praise and worship God. And it talks about this in his sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. So it talks about the sacrifice of Christ, right, on Calvary, that he has died for us, and once and for all. So it's not like every Mass you die in, right? Not very tough. You know how many Masses around the world. But it is quite supernatural in a way when you think about it, right? It's only one sacrifice. But every time during Mass, when we have that liturgy, we are time traveling to the same point where Jesus is being sacrificed. So all points of time travels back into the same point of time, pointing towards there, see? So it's like, simultaneous time travel from all over the world, It's and it happens because the bread, as we believe, the bread is being transformed into the body and blood of Christ. Okay? And it is by this sacrifice, he pours out the graces of salvation, right, of his body, which is the church. So he pours out, because of his sacrifice, they are being saved by him. Okay, so everything that you read here, you already know. Very smart Catholics here. Okay, so it's being broken down into the liturgy of the word and liturgy of the Eucharist. Okay, so this one, right, if you are not zooming your whole life of your Catholic life, you know that there's a liturgy of the word and there's a liturgy of the Eucharist in general, right? Maybe you forget that you do the sign of the cross or whether you have done the Gloria, but you will know that the word, you know, there's like somebody reading or some sound coming from somebody's mouth. You know, or some the priest leave the bread or whatever. So even though it's zombie, at least you'll see that. Huh? If you zombie, I'm just saying. So we go very deep into the problems we face during Mass because we already be an expert of Mass. But you know, what we really face is that we being, most of us being cradle Catholics, right? Or you know, later you become Catholic for a long time, you will face the problem because you go to Mass so much and you're like, you know, and you like, you know, you will have some issues, right? Like some of us are facing now, right? Okay, one of the issues that we face is being on time, right? So this one is one of my major issues. So you guys can hear me in this. Okay, I've been on time for Mass. I'm 80% on time. Weekday and weekend combined. So weekend, Sunday Mass, I'm like 99% on time. For, we played 10 years now. Okay. So, but then you know, I mean, like, it is not uncommon, right? If you run for Mass and you've got children, you know, it is going to be more difficult, right, Stephanie?
Yes.
Okay. So, so one of the things you might want to do for people who are single, I mean, for children, you cannot help you, but one of the things for singles you can do is, you know, you can plan the night before, right? Basically, sleep earlier, which is very difficult for all of us. On a Saturday night, later you're going to party after this or supper. So, no, but then remember to go back early, right? Sleep, right? If you really need to party, then go for a later Mass. But then, even though you are going for later Mass, you also must prepare yourself so that you're not late for Mass, okay? So, I read the book that Irma was sending me, and Mark Hart says being on time is late and early is on time.
Wow.
This is very important, and later you'll see why. Right? So if you just go in and rush into the church, then you know most of the time you'll be still somewhat late now. Right? If you claim to be on time. So it is good to be early and coming for Mass. So then, one of the questions that you might want to ask yourself, if you do journaling, then you might want to journal down the things, right? If I'm late, am I only late for Mass, right? Say for example, am I late for work? Okay, if you are a person like me, sometimes I'm late for work as well. I'm not only late for Mass, I'm also late for work.
No, we know.
But then the late for work is because it's 6 p.m. But late for Mass, a bit more unforgivable because there's a lot of Mass time. Okay, so then what does it say about my relationship? Right? So, you know, I realize that I might be late for Mass, I might be late for work, but
for everything else. Permission. Permission.
Some of my friends are on time. Not all my friends, I'm sorry, but yes. So I must confess that yes, for some of the appointments I'm quite late. But then you know, some of the and this helps me to reflect what is my relationship with Christ and with the rest of the people. Right. So you know, it reflects something, right? It can say talk about, you know, you might be you might have too much activities, right? You might be too bad. Then you might need to cut down, right? You might be too tired, right? You might be cut down. You cannot cut down mass. Mass is the priority, right? You know, but then if you are late, then you have to look at what you are doing, right? And also, you know, I realize this as well, but then, you know, you might be late, but don't be too harsh on yourself. Look at it, right? And allow yourself to learn and improve. And slowly you'll be better. Right? And yeah, but don't indulge yourself to be late. You know? And this is something that I will ask you to look at it, right? And to help yourself, to ask your friends, you know, to help you as well, to be on time for mass. And it actually goes down to the other problem that we might have, right? So which is paying attention in mass, right?
What's
so,
what?
So this is very common, right? Sometimes we go for mass, before we know it, it's already our father already. What happened? Really, you already start to dreaming and all that. So, you know, it happens. Especially if you go for weekday mass, it's very common, right? So the readings is like 10 minutes, normally very short. Then by the time you reach our father is about 20 minutes or 15 minutes. And you're like, what happened? Right, it happens before, I mean to many of us. So, you know, especially you think about lunch and all that, Sunday, yeah? So many activities you plan. No, and one of the ways that we can try to not to lose attention in mass is that we have to come early to settle down. Like sometimes when we rush in, right, we are still panting and all that, we find our seats and all that, and we're like, what's happening and all that, our second reading, gospel reading, and you're still panting, you're thinking about my stupid bus, I'm so late night. After you know it, we already finish our homily reading. So it's important to settle down, right? Sometimes even though your body has settled down, your mind is still thinking about, you know, the stupid boss that gives you a lot of work, you know, somebody, you know, you're thinking of a cat, somebody took your cat, things like that. So allow yourself to come down, right? You know, things when you are quiet, sometimes things might come to you, right? You know, things that you're trying to suppress during the weekdays, like, you know, the irritating colleague or your boss or everything, anything will come. So that's why you need more time. So for me, I would definitely require some time to settle down my mind. And that's very important as well. One of the ways that you can do to settle down is to practice being the presence of the Lord. So basically, sometimes how we do this is really to my wife Basil has. So for some of us who have gone for the workshop, you know, it's really basically something very simple, just taking deep breath. And now, just controlling your breath, right? You know, knowing that you are in the space of God. But coming to that space again. Actually, you can do this for everywhere, but the church is easier because hopefully the environment helps you to be in the presence. And that's very important, coming into the presence. So in the church, it is the place for you to practice. Right, so that you can do in your workplace, you can do at home, you can do anywhere else. On the crowded bus, you can do that, you know, if you can center yourself down, you can be with God even though in the crowded place. You will have your space and your time with the Lord. In that sense. So sometimes it might take a longer time, so you have to silence ourselves on the journey towards coming to church. So it might be difficult with your friends, right? So but then maybe you want to help yourself to stay quiet. You know, if you find that it's really very difficult, you might want to take out the readings and help you to focus on something, right? Basically, the readings will help you to at least keep your mind focused on maybe one word that you might want to repeat. As you keep silent. So this is important because you know one of the aspects of the mass is really listening to the word of God, right, which is Jesus. So if we are not quiet, we might not be able to catch what Jesus is trying to tell us during the liturgy. And this can be, you know, very, you'll find that, you know, suddenly, you'll find that the liturgy of the word will be quite meaningless, like you don't get anything, right? Just a whole bunch of people, a whole bunch of whole stories that doesn't make sense to you at all, right? And this will help you to look at your daily lives, right? And you will know, right, for your testimony, some verses pop into your head. So somehow, somewhere, one of the reader has got into your head, maybe one Sunday when it was bright and beautiful, and you watch a good Korean drama, and you happy. Or maybe even before that, Father Terry, you know. So it's like, so okay. It's very important, right? The word of God comes to us in our daily lives, especially when the times when we are, when we have difficulties, right? You know, times when we need it the most, He'll come to us in a very profound manner. So one other thing is finding meaning in us, right? So you see the little girl down there looking very glum, right? Okay, that actually might be us. Still, no, in a bigger body, but still like that, not showing our face, right? Still going through the motions, new stand and all that, and maybe, you know, new sit, stand, or whatever. But deep within, maybe we are still at that side. Yeah, why am I here? No, I don't feel anything, right? Mass doesn't have any meaning at all. So, you know, one of the things that we're going to look at is our relationship with God. And so basically, Mass could be a good place where, you know, if you do the examining of conscience, right, it is the time where, for that short time, believer that God, it calls to mind our sins and our faults, especially the one that talks in our head fastest. Right, those are things that we have really feel. Then you were like, okay, through my fault. Don't hit too hard, like, even though like this, maybe you find that you have failed. But then recognize it, right? Before you go for Mass, as in, no, before you receive Jesus, right? We go to Him in humility and recognize that, yes, it is true my fault. Or we can look at where we're being blessed, right? Especially when we give up our what we have received from God in the offering. Right, the offering that goes together with the sacrifice of Jesus in form of bread and wine. So that is where we have been blessed. And also, maybe a call to renew our lives and to try once again weekly, every time we receive the increase. Right? We come together not as a single person, but in a whole group, you know, the whole community and whole congregation, you know, asking, coming back to Jesus once again. To try and to receive Him and to try and to be better more and more. Liturgy of the word, right? So, you know, I think sometimes we struggle with the liturgy of the word, and I just like to share some of the things that helps me to over the years what has really helped me. And I think and what I've experienced is that, you know, for Old Testaments, right, sometimes, you know, it really strikes me how Old Testament stories come about. You know, there are times that you can relate to Abraham, right, when Abraham is sacrificing Isaac. So how difficult is it for him to bring Isaac there and to be sacrificed? You know, it calls to mind where, in our lives, what are the Isaacs in our life that God is calling us to give up? It might bring to mind, the Old Testament might bring to mind Moses, right? He might be there leading the people out in the wilderness, you know? When we are doing well, we are feel like we are like Moses parting the Red Sea, like, wow! So, like praise and worship, everybody is responding to me, wow! You know? When you parted the Red Sea, you feel like, you know, God is always with you. But when people start to grumble and all that, you might feel like Moses leading them 40 days in the desert and, you know, to try to strike the rock and for the water to come out and all that, and people are still grumbling. And that might be at workplace as well, you know. You might find that you're under a lot of heat in the desert, and you might be feeling that you've been working 40 years in the desert, and that's all in your life, you know. That's where you can really feel, you know, like, and God has been there, but it's just that, you know, He's asking you to continue walking. So, you can be Abraham, you can be Moses, you can be Jacob, you can be a lot of these Old Testament characters. So, really the sacred scriptures is about relationship with God, right? If you look in the lens of the relationship with God, it can really come to life very powerfully in that sense. For me, the Old Testament was the one that comes to me powerfully. The Psalms, I think, how the Psalms relate to me is that the Psalms actually spoke to me, you know, the emotions of the Psalm speaks to me. So I want to just take up today's Psalm to share with you. Just hold on a minute. So, right, the Psalms always has a certain, you know, you look at Psalms, right, these are the pop songs, the top 150 pop songs of that time, where they would sing about, you know, the people who are more emo at that time, they were. The composer, King David is the top emo king that composed a lot of it, so Solomon composed some of it, and other people composed a bit of it. So, right. So no, his life is very difficult, you must really, you know. But he's a songwriter, he's like,
okay, 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 I shall sing.
It's in the Bible, you know. So it says here, right, today's Psalm, right? Saturday, yeah? Psalm 7. O Lord, my God, in you I take refuge. Right. So this is somebody who feels that, you know, they are going through a very difficult time. Right. So do me justice, O Lord, because I am just, and because the innocence that is mine. Let the malice of the wicked come to an end, but sustain the just. O searcher of heart and soul, O just God. So you might be suffering in the office where, you know, you find that your boss treats you. Right, you might feel that your colleagues is not being fair to you. You might be looking for a job and you might feel that the whole world is against you, you know, and you need somebody to help you in the refuge. And that's why the emotions of that, you can relate to the psalmist, right? Yesterday was the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. And I'm sure everybody who have gone through this, right, they will know. You know, if you read into the emotions of the psalmist, they will talk to you, right? So every Sunday there will be psalms, every day there will be psalms, right? Okay, the whole church is there. Okay, you might also feel so emo this week, right? But somebody out there might feel emo. So the thing is that, right, the psalm actually brings the whole church together to feel with that guy that who might be going through a difficult moment. And if it's you on that day, then it's like you speak at the jackpot, and you know, the whole church is with you. It's like you feel emo during the psalm, you will feel emo during the middle. But some of them will be okay. So it does really speak to you, right? And of course then there's the gospel. Right, so today's gospel I think is very beautiful. It says, this is truly the prophet, others say this is the Christ. But others, the Christ is not, will not come from Galilee, will he? Does not scripture say that the Christ will be of David's family? Come from Bethlehem, the village where David lived. So a division occurred in the crowd because of him. Some of them even wanted to arrest him, but no one laid hands on him. Right, so if you look at this, sometimes you might think that, you know, you might want to help other people, you know, in your time. But then some people might look at you and say, no lah, no, this person cannot be, especially people who are close to you, your family and all that. And you might be sent to God to help them. And sometimes you might be misunderstood from your well intentions and all that. And in a way, you can really relate to Jesus in this time of being misunderstood, being mistaken for somebody who is trying to, you know, as a faker, like somebody who is being fake. And this happens a lot, you know, in the office. there's some where ego and emotions runs high, and it can be very difficult. And this is where, you know, you can really relate with Jesus, how it is, you know, and how he is walking with you and how he's persevering with you. So the scriptures can be really, you know, talking about your life and all that. And it is where, you know, it is an invitation for us to open our ears and hear that, you know, he's with us, or there's something that he wants to tell us. So intercessory prayers, sorry. So the Mass is really a great platform of intercessory prayer, because it gathers a big group of people to come to pray, even though sometimes their soul might not be there, even though their body is there, like some of us. So, but then it is still a group of people praying. And it is fantastic, because the Mass is really the summit of worship. So it is where really God really listens. And it is really a good place for us to speak to the Lord. You know, if we speak to the Lord from our heart, then it is where that, you know, you will know that he will listen. But of course your answer is not ready. So the liturgy of the Eucharist is specifically about, you know, specifically receiving Jesus in the Eucharist. So being one with Jesus, right, and being closer to God. So the equivalent language of the Eucharist, you know, receiving the Eucharist, is actually the marital language, where one being one with your spouse, right? So it's the conjugal. It's a sexual act where you become one with your spouse. So in that even closer way, God comes being one with you. So you know that this being oneness is really talking about making a commitment to love more and also to sacrifice yourself more. So not only you sacrificing and loving more, but God also loving and sacrificing for you even more. So that is a very act of closeness then. So that is why they say that, you know, if you commit mortal sin, then don't take the Eucharist. So that would be like, you know, committing adultery and still trying to, you know, sleep with your spouse. So that would be totally wrong. So really, you know, coming to that very close, you know, relationship with God, even though that you've not done very well, but yet still coming to him, you know, in surrender. And one of the ways that I feel that a very good way that you can, for me to receive Jesus, right, especially at times I don't feel very good, is to really ask Mother Mary to lend us a heart, her immaculate heart, right, which is pure and untouched by sin, so that we can receive Jesus even better into ourselves. So that is something that, you know, I was being taught, and there are times where I really feel that this is really where it really helped me to come into that presence, mine, to receive Jesus. Okay, so what is the Eucharist? Okay, so we know that Eucharist is the bread of, is the body of Christ, body and blood of Christ. Okay, so, but then I just want to take a scientific look at what is the Eucharist. So as you can see, this is the picture of taken from the Eucharist, right? It is the Eucharistic miracle of, okay, I'm not pronouncing this is in Poland, right? So I know that the pronunciation will be totally wrong. So this miracle happened when the priest was giving a Eucharist to somebody who was kneeling, and he saw this, and this happened. And for more details, you can, I'll give you the link later, you can look. But what I want to point out is that, right, in 2008, this is one of the most recent Eucharistic miracle, right? They actually took the Eucharist to find out what it is, right? They did a scientific study of it. And they found that, oh, this is actually heart tissue, right? This Eucharist, that part that has become blood and flesh, has become heart tissue. And not just any heart tissue, right? It is not a dead tissue, but it's a living tissue, but showing past present before death. right, just before dying, but not dying yet. So they will tell you that it is from which part of the heart and all that. So this is really, you know, a very scientific study for people who might not even be Christians, but looking at this. And it comes from, this is a website, it comes from this guy which know who has passed on. So this guy is on his path to Cebu, who has already passed on. And this young Kiki guy, who's I think 15 years old at the time, he collected all the Eucharistic miracles and put them on this website. There's an English version also, so you can see. And in it, he documents like, you know, what has happened, the scientific studies on that, right? And also what has happened, right? So, but from this, we can see that, you know, what is the Eucharist actually? The Eucharist is actually the Sacred Heart of Christ. So he's not just giving, you know, a part of his food, you know, a part of his buttocks. No, he's giving his heart, right? So which is where that it is the most precious. So he's giving us his heart so that we can, when we receive his heart into our hearts, right? So our hearts can be together. And it is something that I think is, for me, when I, and this is not the only miracle that they studied and found it to be heart tissue. Almost every miracle that they did a scientific study, they found that it's heart tissue. Right? Even one of the earliest miracles, I think in Italy, about 1,000 years before, they studied, they found that the blood is AB, right? AB is the blood that receives all, right? So, all receives everybody, not only Christian blood, but all the blood of humanity. And the flesh tissue, right, together with the blood, is the tissue of the heart tissue as well. Okay, so moving on to Eucharistic adoration. So I think one of the stories that touched me, some of the stories that touched me about Eucharistic adoration, not really Eucharistic adoration, sorry. Eucharist is one of the sermons that John Vianney gave. Right? John Vianney is he's not a very intelligent priest per se. He took a long time to finish his priestly study, and even then he just barely passed. And people like want him to be a priest, but then he sent him to a faraway place to preach. And he became a great preacher as well. So one of the homilies he preached was, he just sat down there and pointed to the tabernacle. This is Jesus. And he continues saying that this is Jesus. And this is Jesus. So he does this continuously, and the congregation heard this and they started to cry. You know, they started to weep and they realized that this is Jesus. And that was one of the great, you know, realization and the miracle you can realize that, you know, Jesus is there for them. Really beautiful for, you know, these are the people that don't know, they have no education, and yet they could feel that the love of Jesus for them. Another story I heard of is from the saint is St. John Paul II. So, as you know, St. John Paul II travels a lot, like he goes to different countries and all that. So there was once this story, I think who's that guy? Jason Abbott actually shared this, but I think that maybe a lot of people have really left it, you know, for the readers. So I'd like to share this one. So, and this is the one that also touched me a lot. So there was once John Paul II went to visit USA. Then, you know, and one of the, they were preparing the place where, you know, John Paul II will come and visit the seminary and all that. Then they're like, okay, oh, this part, you know, they were walking past this place, and, oh, this part where the Eucharist is not okay, you have to close the door, you know? Because every time when he comes here, he sees the Blessed Sacrament, then he will spend some time over there. You know, the last time he spent some time over there is 45 minutes, and the whole schedule will be screwed up. So we need to, like, you know, don't let him see the Blessed Sacrament, then after that, you have to, like, try to close the door and all that. Right, so they do that. So, during that time when John Paul II was going through the place and he was like, you know, just visiting and all that. So as he passed by, then he stopped.
then look back, you know, the person that was accompanying him, and he look at him and he like, and he went into the room and spent like 45 minutes down there in the Blessed Sacrament. So it speaks a huge amount of the relationship that, you know, St. John Paul II has the Blessed Sacrament, you know, he with the Pope, right? It is said that he spends daily about 20 or 30 times, you know, praying to the Blessed Sacrament. That is where I felt that it was very beautiful, because it was really the kind of relationship and closeness that he has with Jesus. You know, despite still being the Pope and still finding the time to be with the God that loved him. So, who are we to say that, you know, we don't need this great and wondrous miracle, this great and wondrous God that is always there for us, you know, He who has given His life. Especially in desolate times where we don't feel anything, right? It is a place where you can find, I will not say that maybe you can find peace inside, but then being there is really one of the visible signs that He is there, right? When you're feeling very down, and I feel that I see so many people inside, right, secretly crying, maybe not so secret, they're crying in front of the Blessed Sacrament. And that's where really they found refuge, you know, they found tears of healing, they found, you know, a sense, a place where they could allow themselves to be loved by God, even if they don't feel it, you know, just being there. You know, really helps. In good times, you know, I think this is quite easy where, you know, there are times where, and sometimes we forget, right? Sometimes, you know, when we receive blessings and all that, you know, we sometimes forget God. But He's there, right? Being with Him during good times, you know, you could really feel that He's always there. His immense peace, His immense love. You know, the times where you will find that, you know, you are close to God. This is where, you know, going there helps you to build that love, that relationship with Him. Really, actually, any time is really a good time to go, because, you know, having that, right, is you will find a pillar in your spiritual life. You'll find that He is always there, and, you know, you could always trust in God. In His. For me, I think I've been going to the Eucharistic Adoration for quite some time. It started with me really sleeping there. It ended with me still sleeping there. I think Thursday I was still sleeping there. But I was in cathedral, I think I was like, I hope I didn't snore too long. So, but you never know, I think the people are very nice in heaven. But it's... When I'm tired, right, He allows me to rest there. No, when I come out of the adoration room, I'm still like, oh, my eyes are very heavy. But when I come out, after I come out, I feel very rested. I feel I've got energy to continue. It's really wondrous, you know, like, can be like a week of not enough sleep, but going in there, I feel totally rested coming out. At least rested enough for me to go home, then after that, go and sleep on But it's really, you know, a kind of like rest that is very good, that you might not even get it anywhere. You know, it's a time when you are very sad, you know, and it really helps you to allow you to have a place where you, you know, where you can tell nobody God is there for you, right? And in times that, you know, you want to thank God, right, there's no better place than to really spend time and thank Him. And for me, it's really, you know, and I can tell you, I go there and pray. There are times when I pray, I don't know whether I've wasted time or not. I think it's never time wasted. Just keep in mind that, you know, don't have expectation. You know, like if you go down there and try to do Lexio Divina, definitely Lexio Divina, you're like, wow, suddenly I receive so many things. Okay, you might, right? Okay, I'm not saying you might not, right? But don't go in with that expectation. Go in for the sake of Jesus Himself. Right, the person who loves you. Alright, so, you know, in times when you cannot receive communion, there's this method called spiritual communion. Okay, this is only when it's physically not possible for you to receive communion, right? So, cannot skip mass. This one. Okay, so making a spiritual communion with the prayers here. Okay, so it is a deep desire to receive Jesus when it is physically not possible. And I've tried this before, and it's very powerful, right? You really feel that being there, and you know, it's very powerful. I cannot put it in words, it's supernatural, but you know, that you really receive Jesus. I mean, out of 1,000 times you receive Jesus, maybe 2 or 3 times you feel deeply touched. And I tried this, and I do feel deeply touched with Jesus. Right? So, St. Thomas Aquinas said that, you know, coming in him, and a few saints wrote about it, it's not a very new age thingy. Right? Thomas Aquinas is 12 something AD, right? And he said that it's in loving and embrace of him. And this saint is St. John Vianney, he says, when we feel the love of God growing cold, let us instantly make the spiritual communion. Right, especially when we are far away from church or the church is closed midnight, you know, you cannot find any church, then yeah. Okay, conclusion. Okay, so read two things. Okay, Eucharist is a wonderful gift and a great sign of how God loves us. There's a need to persist in being with Christ in all states of our life. So receiving the Eucharist is really that, and it is what He meant us to be in, right? In all states of life, we receive the Eucharist through us. And Jesus is waiting for us daily in the Eucharist, so do we accept His invitation to go to the grave. Okay, that's all.